Hello, everyone. Welcome to Developmental Psychology, DEP 2004. I am Dr. Rivera. Hello, everyone. In this next couple of videos, I'm going to talk about Chapter 1. I'm going to talk a little bit about the history of developmental psychology. I'm going to talk about a few of the theories in general that we're going to talk about throughout the semester. And I'm going to finish up talking a little bit about the scientific method and specifically the research designs that are sometimes used in developmental psychology. First of all, developmental psychology is the study of human development. That actually means a lot of things. Humans develop in a lot of different ways, biologically, psychologically, socioculturally. There's just a lot of different ways that we grow and change. Therefore, developmental psychology takes information and theories from a lot of different fields of science, including biology and psychology and other social sciences. Essentially, what developmental psychology is trying to understand is a few things. First of all, how do we grow? How do we go from a baby, this thing that can't really interact too much, doesn't communicate with language, is almost helpless without somebody, to an adult who is completely capable of thinking and doing things on their own, making their own plans, etc., into an older person where our body starts to wear down, our mind sometimes starts to wear down. And so how does that growth occur, both physically and mentally, neurologically? What are the actual changes that are occurring? But developmental psychology also wants to know other things, things like, how come we can all be so different? How come, you know, we come from the same culture or the same country, maybe even the same family, and yet people can be so different from one another. And then in some ways, people can be so similar, even very different people can be very similar to one another. And how come that happens, right? So the theories in developmental psychology and the studies that come out of developmental psychology are always trying to figure out one of those aspects. How do we grow? Why are we changing? How are we changing? And also, how is it that even though we're all so different, we can be so similar? And how is it that even people who you would expect to be very similar are in fact sometimes so different from one another? And again, in that way, we're trying to follow the physiological changes, cognitive, emotional changes, social changes that affect us throughout our lives. Now, another important thing to understand about developmental psychology is a little bit of the history. Today, when we think about children, we think of people who are not complete yet. They have not learned the things they need to learn in order to be regular adults or normal people. They don't know how to walk if they're young enough. They don't know how to talk if they're young enough. But even if they do know how to walk and talk, maybe they don't have the ability to think logically just yet. And maybe they do think logically, but they haven't mastered it, right? That's what it means to be a child. It means that you're growing and learning. Part of that is just biological and it's natural maturity because you're getting older. And other parts of that have to do with you just learning. But that's not always the way we saw children. It wasn't that long ago in the grand scheme of things that people didn't think of children as growing people, but instead they thought of children as tiny adults. And when that tiny adult didn't do what they were supposed to, people really did believe that those tiny adults were just being bad. And in fact, in most of ancient history, that was sort of the perspective of children, was children did bad things because they wanted to do bad things. And you had to beat the devil out of them. That's something that people really did say about children, right? They were being bad on purpose. And if you spare the rod, you're going to spoil the child because you have to get that evil thinking out of them. And so really into the Middle Ages, and especially the Middle Ages, this was a very normal viewpoint about children. Now, it's not really until around the late 1600s and 1700s that a shift starts to occur. It starts to occur because of the writings of John Locke and Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Now, their ideas are very different from one another, but what's important about them is that they are a shift away from that ancient way of thinking about children being born kind of evil. So Locke believes that children are in fact born with a blank slate, right? It's he called it a tabula rasa. That just means a clean slate. Think of like a clean chalkboard. And it's society, it's family life, it's the world culture that writes on that chalkboard or on that slate and allows a child to grow. And so whatever society writes on that slate for that child, then that child is going to grow up that way. And so if you write bad things, then that child is going to grow up maybe to be a criminal or to be bad. And if you write good things, then that child will grow up to be good. And Rousseau, on the other hand, believed that in fact children are naturally good. They're born good. And if somebody grows up to be bad, it's because society made them bad. Now, why is this happening? Well, it's happening because there's a change in culture that's occurring. Before the Renaissance and before end of the Middle Ages, the community was all that was good. It's all that you knew. Most people lived in small communities. And anybody who walked out into the darkness, into the woods, there was a chance that that person didn't come back. And when people looked out into the woods, there were animals there and things that looked evil. And so it was very normal for people to think that being closer to society meant that you were good, and it meant that God was near. And walking away from society, that meant that you were walking into evil, and maybe the devil is out there. But what starts to happen towards the end of the Middle Ages and into the Renaissance is that societies get really, really large. And suddenly, in large, big societies, you start to see a lot of evil, not outside where there are animals and trees and woods, but inside society. You see people being bad, and you see poverty and people hungering and, you know, turning to criminality. And all of a sudden, there's new questions. And so new thinkers like Locke and Rousseau at the time started to see the old world as being good, meaning nature as being good, and society as being bad. And so that shift in the way people are thinking also changes the way we think about children. And all of a sudden, you get these new ideas. Children are a blank slate. If they're bad, it's because society or family made them bad. They wrote something bad in their slate. Or, like Rousseau, children are actually born good, and it's in fact bad society that turns them into criminals. Again, for a long time, these were thoughts philosophies that people believed just wholeheartedly. And really, it's into the 1800s that, probably in the late 1800s, that we start to see a change in that. So up until this point, when people talked about growing old, they usually talked about being an infant, being an adult, or being an older person, an old man or an old woman. And if you were an 8-year-old boy, people would tell you things like, ah, you're a man now. It's time to start thinking about getting a job. It's time to start thinking about starting a family. And if you were an 8-year-old girl, people would tell you, oh, you're getting to be a woman now. It's time to start thinking about getting married. Now, the thing about that is that if you're an 8-year-old in a very pastoral life, well, you know what? The people around you are your parents, or they at least know your family. And so they're not letting you do things that you're not good at because they care about whether you live or die. But something weird happens in the 1800s, which is the Industrial Revolution starts to occur. And suddenly, people aren't working in farms anymore. Instead, adults are leaving their house and they're going off to work in factories. And the problem is that for these people, 8-year-olds were adults. And so 8-year-olds also left their house and went to work in factories. But there's a problem in a factory with an 8-year-old, is that the manager there doesn't care about this kid. And so you see a lot of kids just dying because of machinery and getting hurt, getting maimed. And so people start to realize that there's something just off about that. And they start to understand that, in fact, 8-year-olds are not adults. 8-year-olds are their own little stage. They are children. And it is right around the beginning of the Industrial Revolution where we start to see this change occur. And of course, we see it faster in the higher classes. Rich people don't have to send their 8-year-olds off to work. Whereas if you're a poor family, well, you have greater need for that money. But slowly but surely, there is this change that occurs in our culture where we start seeing children, as being separate from adults. Now, it is right around the same time where Stanley G. Hall is doing studies on childhood. And one of the things that he starts to notice is that there's in fact another stage, a stage that is called adolescence. And Stanley G. Hall in his studies suggests that there, between childhood and adulthood, there is in fact this other stage called adolescence. It's not really until around the 1950s where culture kind of catches up with research. And we start to notice, or we start to accept, that in fact this group, teenagers, are their own stage. And we give teenagers time to grow up. And we don't throw them out into the world right away. And in fact, we kind of imprison them in schools for long periods of time so that they can learn how to be adults and interact with other teenagers, etc. But this is a change that really is almost modern. 1950s is not that long ago, where in our culture, where we think about teenagers as being a separate stage. Now, developmental studies continued throughout the century, and Stanley G. Hall is often considered the father of developmental psychology. The other gentleman you see there is Alfred Binet, who, along with Theodore Simon, invented the IQ test. We'll talk a little bit about them later on when we talk about intelligence. But as those studies continue into the modern time, well, those stages, infancy and childhood and adolescence, adulthood and old age, we've continued to grow them because we've continued to understand that, in fact, there are way more stages of development than just that. And today, in our class in modern times, we're going to talk about not only infancy, but also the group of children that we call neonates or newborns, and then infants, toddlers. Childhood will usually split up into early, middle, and late childhood, adolescence, and adulthood and old age. And more, we'll talk a little bit more about another stage that is most obvious in cultures like ours, where adolescents and young adults have a long time to decide what to do. But I mean, it exists everywhere. It's just most obvious in cultures like ours, because we actually kind of set a space out for that stage. And that stage is what we call emerging adulthood. Depending on how old the study you're reading is, they might call, you know, late adolescence, and they'll talk about adolescence into your 20s and 30s. But more and more, the term that is used now is emerging adulthood. And that's kind of the stage where you guys are probably at. You guys are mostly leaving behind your adolescence and entering your emerging adulthood. Why is this important to talk about? Well, without this stage in the middle, basically what we're saying is that an 18-year-old and a 48-year-old are the same stage. And we kind of know just inherently that that's not the case, right? There are very different ways of thinking and understanding, and just the things that are important can be very different from an 18-year-old to a 48-year-old. And in emerging adulthood, what's happening is that you are thinking about who you are as a person. You're an adult, but you don't have the same trappings in emerging adulthood as you do in normal adulthood, where you have to provide for a family and you are trying to move up in a job that you've been at for many years. When you're in emerging adulthood, a lot of times you start a job and you realize, I don't want to do this, and you leave that job. You start a relationship and you realize, I don't want to do this, and you leave that relationship. People move a lot. They might move to a different country, to a different state. They might move back. And in emerging adulthood, you have a lot of freedom to do that, especially in our culture. Our culture gives emerging adulthood a lot of freedom to move and change and make decisions about who it is that they want to be. Whereas when you're an adult, those freedoms, they're not quite as easy to take. As I mentioned, you have a family to take care of usually. You have a job that you don't want to lose because you've been there and, you know, you have a pension maybe. From adulthood, then we'll move on into late adulthood. Now, a lot of what we're going to talk about throughout the semester is also this, what we sometimes call the lifespan perspective. How is it that we are changing? And how is it that our changes are physical? There you see Marlon Brando throughout his life. And he looks very different from his childhood picture into his picture as an old man. But there's also a lot of growth, internal growth, that occurred throughout those stages, both good and sometimes bad. Sometimes psychologically healthy things that make us more functional, and sometimes things that are not psychologically healthy that kind of debilitate us as we get older. All right, everyone. Thanks for watching. Let me know if you have any questions. And remember that the best way to contact me is directly through Canvas. I hope to hear from you soon.